Welcome to Second Take, the show that takes a look at the issues behind the news. It has been a frantic week on the electricity front as South Africa recovered from its first load shedding relapse since 2008. Terence Creamer has been following developments and joins me to talk about what happened and the outlook. Hi, Terence.
Hi.
What went wrong on March 6th? And are we in as bad a position as we were in 2008?
Yeah, as with the 2008, it came down to the wet coal situation. Now, it's not the problem is not wet coal in itself. The problem was that the coal was both wet and fine. And that basically clogged up the logistical system between one mine and one power station in particular. And that was the Kendal Power Station in Mpumalanga. And the tired mine there is the Kutala Colliery, run by BHP Billiton. And during a period of a shift change at the underground mine, it seems that the coarse coal that came through from that mine, the drier and the coarser coal that comes from the underground section, stopped for a period. And that was supplemented with a lot of wet, fine coal from the open car section at Kutala. And in the process, everything got clogged up. It really, it's fine, slurry type material. And it meant that the conveyor systems couldn't transport the coal. And it meant that eventually that four units at Kendal got stranded from their primary energy source for a period of time. And it took literally the whole day of Thursday, during which Eskom was load shedding, to clear up those systems to get Kendal back on load. So it did come down to one major power station, really. There were losses throughout the system because the coal was wet, and there were some other issues at Majuba as well that were unrelated to wet coal that led to a lot of load being lost, up to 10,000 megawatts. Now, this is at a time when Eskom's doing a lot of maintenance, so they've got about between 4,000 and 6,500 megawatts of capacity out for planned outage at any one stage. So the system in summer, and if we go back, there's a lot of concern generally around winter, but if you go back to when we've had load shedding in South Africa, it's always been in the summer months, whether you go back to 2006 in the Cape Town incident, or whether you go back to 2008 where the load shedding took place over a period of months. It was again in the summer months when there's rain, when there's a lot of maintenance underway, and that was a repeated situation in many ways on March the 6th, where a lot of load got lost, and there's not a lot of spinning capacity available as we have in winter to take up that slack. So basically, Eskom first declared the emergency early in the morning, around 5-6 in the morning, which meant that its large customers were compelled to cut by 10%. That wasn't sufficient. And then by 8 o'clock that morning, we entered into our first load shedding relapse since 2008. But the difference this time is that the relapse was fairly short. So it wasn't a protracted period of rotational load shedding. And by 10 o'clock that night, it was lifted. The load shedding and the emergency was lifted, and the system had been stabilized. So I think there is a difference between now and 2008. In 2008, Eskom was really unprepared for that period of wet coal. There weren't stockpiles of coal on site. There weren't protocols in place to communicate. And the diagnosis of the problems in 2008 took some time, and there were a lot of meetings, and it went on for many weeks, where just diagnosing and analysing what the problems were and getting to grips with it took a lot of time. Whereas I think Eskom this time around, the big difference, they were able to analyse and diagnose the problem quite quickly. They were able to communicate the problem that they were in very quickly, fairly effectively. Yes, it was very painful. We went into a whole day of load shedding, businesses closed, and cell phone networks went down. It was a very uncomfortable feeling for South Africans. But by 10 o'clock that night, they were able to restore it. Are we out of the woods? I think Eskom's saying no, that because there's this high level of summer maintenance and they're not going to pull back on that, that the system remains vulnerable to any large load loss. But I think that the protocols are far better than they were in 2008. and things, you know, I think that there's a feeling in society that nothing's changed. But I think that if you look at the way Eskom communicated and recovered from that episode, I think there has been progress. It's still unacceptable in some ways that we're going into load shedding because, you know, we've pumped a lot of resources into Eskom. There's a lot of attention and knowledge about how vulnerable the system is. And therefore, you know, there should have been other ways probably to get through this summer without load shedding, and that was the aim. But we haven't got through the summer without load shedding, and the situation remains vulnerable till I suppose all those units that are out for maintenance start coming up in preparation for winter. And the difference between winter and summer is that the summer has a fairly flat profile over the day, but in winter we hit those evening peaks between 5 and 9, and that is why Eskom is wanting to have as much power capacity back ready for that, and spinning, so that when we start getting to those 36,000 megawatts of consumption in the evening peaks, there's enough capacity to meet that. But we're definitely going to be vulnerable until Medupi and Kusile come on.
And what is being done to deal with the wet coal problem that is once again being blamed for load shedding?
Yes, I mean, there's a lot of action that has been taken, and there are a lot of remedies and solutions that have been proposed to Eskom. Eskom has introduced some of those, but they feel others, for instance, covering all the coal stockpiles, some of the spraying solutions are with chemicals they've also looked at, they just feel they don't have the financial resources for. But I think they are really re-looking at those options. But I think the main immediate remedy is seen in restoring at some power stations some coarse coal stockpiles. So the issue is not wet coal, it's when it's wet and fine. And all those coarse coal stockpiles have been run down during this fairly protracted period of wet weather. And they're in engagement initially with the Chamber of Mines and then with the Colliery Committee at the Chamber to say, how can we, you know, replenish these urgently, and how can we do it at a cost that's not at export parity price type levels, because this is the sort of coal that Eskom competes with others for. So there is that discussion underway, and apparently there already are one-on-one contracts being signed to replenish those stocks, and hopefully over the next few weeks and months there will be a full replenishment, so that if there are heavy rains again there will be some way of resorting to those stocks. I think the Kendall situation, there's still an analysis going on, a full investigation is underway, and there's been reports from the Kendall management team as to how they see it. A report has apparently been submitted or requested and given from the bulletin, the BHP bulletin management team at Kutala, and there will be a sort of analysis to see whether those sort of match up. If not, there'll probably be further interrogation. But I think the message from Eskom is, if the coal being delivered is wet and fine, rather put those onto a stockpile and tell the management of the power station to rather start resorting to their stockpiles rather than pushing that new fresh but wet and fine coal straight directly into the power station.
And what needs to be done to ensure that South Africa doesn't lurch from emergency to emergency?
Well, we do have this medium-term risk mitigation plan. It was endorsed in 2010, and it has various supply-side options and demand-side management options available. Some of those were being implemented quite successfully by Eskom under standard-offered programs, and we saw, you know, energy efficiency rollouts across a number of industrial customers in particular. So pumps were changed and more energy-efficient solutions were implemented. Those unfortunately all got stopped in October last year, mostly because Eskom feels they don't have the financial resources to sustain those demand-side management programs, because they requested, as you'll remember, 16% a year over the five-year period from 2013 to 2018, but received 8%. And they've been now having to sort of tailor their business to that reality of lower tariff increases than they had sought. And so they've been cutting a lot of these programs. They also have the supply side from independent power producers and municipalities. Those are also terminated in December, but they have continued with them until the end of May because of the really the supply balance shortfalls. So, but they're saying that, and Eskom is saying, and they're communicating that with government as well as with business this week, that they would like to find a more medium-term or longer-term solution to both restarting the demand-side programs and sustaining the supply-side purchases. And I think there is a serious discussion now underway within government, as well as within society more generally, with Business Unity South Africa now setting up a high-level team to engage with Eskom on this, to look at how we can restart those medium-term risk mitigation plans. So they've been identified, they are known. Some of them can be introduced fairly quickly. It's an issue of finding the finances to restart those programs. And I think the issue is that the cost versus the cost of unserved energy is worth it. But the issue, but the problem is to find those financial resources. And Eskom hasn't found it through the tariff. So it really has to resort back to its shareholder in some form. And that's the South African government, that's the South African taxpayer. So we're going to have to watch that space and see what announcements are made. But I think there's an urgency around that, and there's solutions that are possible. In the longer term, we really need Medupi and Kusile and Angula to come on. Now, we know how much those have been delayed, and we really don't need any further delays. The view is that Medupi's first unit should still come on in the second half of this year, but there are a lot of concerns around whether that deadline will be met, because South Africa has been let down so many times. But there's a lot of attention being given to the Medupi startup, but it can't just be a one unit issue. It has to be a sustained one unit and then followed fairly rapidly by the next. And the same scenario has to play out at Kusile. So we need that capacity. And then once I think we have that capacity on stream, it's going to be an interesting scenario, because it's going to be we're going to have a lot, 9,000 megawatts plus of capacity coming on almost all at once. Is going to change the equation quite dramatically. It will allow Eskom to do a lot more maintenance, which it needs to do, but actually we could be in a situation where we have more than sufficient supply given our low economic growth trajectory. So then Eskom will be looking to try and bring on new capacity, a new demand. And I think until the economy starts growing, we're not going to see that being taken up. But again, that would be a temporary excess. Ultimately, South Africa is energy short, and we've got really old, aging coal-fired fleet. We need to look and start making some decisions for the long term about a sustainable energy mix going well beyond the current coal-fired power station fleet.
Thanks, Terence. That is the Second Take show for this week. Thank you for watching, and join us again next time for more news analysis.